lots of y'all have asked, what happened? I have to tell you, I can't tell a lie. Jessica kissed. Just being, evidently from what the podiatrist said, I was walking along and broke a little bitty bit of bone off of my heel where my Achilles tendon attaches. And so we're in a boot for a few weeks and then we'll go back and reevaluate from there. I appreciate your concern and your prayers. It's already feeling a whole lot better. I'm thankful for that. I'm thankful that the Lord has blessed us to have technology and such as doctors that can do those x-rays and know what to tell you to do. We're blessed folks. This morning we're going to continue our series, Smashing Idols. Idols are those hobbies and habits, people and activities, anything that threatens to take first place in our heart and mind. Things that we worship many times without even realizing that's what we're doing. I've shared with you before what Tim Keeler says about this issue of idolatry. He says anything can serve as a counterfeit god, especially the very best things in life. An idol is anything more important to you than God, anything that absorbs your heart and imagination more than God, anything you seek to give you what only God can give, anything that's so central and essential to your life that should you lose it, your life will hardly feel worth living. We've already seen in this series, it's common for us to take good things and turn them into God things. And if we're really going to talk about idols in our culture today, we can't do that without addressing one of the most common and destructive idols there is, sex, sexuality. I want to share with you what is on my heart as I'm approaching that subject this morning. The Bible has a ton of things to say about sex and sexuality. There's even a book of the Bible committed just to that topic. But in one 30-minute sermon, I cannot, or 35-minute sermon, I cannot more than barely scratch the surface of what God says about sex and sexuality and how it applies to your life. The second thing that I'm aware of is on my heart is that I want our young people to embrace God's view of sexuality and purity. They are exposed to so many perverted lies and destructive thoughts and actions when it comes to sex and sexuality. And people that seem real smart believe some stupid stuff. Some things that destroy lives and families and marriages. And I want our young people to be spared from that chaos from a young age to grow up just knowing God's ways about sex and purity and to embrace those things. And as I approach this subject of sex and sexuality, I feel the weight of brokenness, quite honestly, in this room today. There's brokenness here. All of us have stories of different levels and degrees and from different perspectives. When we talk about sex, there are stories of brokenness and shame in this room today. There are people here who have been deeply hurt and abused. There are people here with broken hearts because you gave something away only later to be thrown away yourself. The pain and frustration that comes with addiction to sex or pornography is in this room. Broken relationships and broken hearts. And some of those hurts are old and callous over. Some of them are wrong and tender to the heart. So as I share what God says about sex and sexuality, I want to share His vision of purity. I want to remind those of us who have been sinned against that we have a God who's going to right every wrong. We can find great strength from Him. And for those who have sinned in this area, I want to remind you of the grace of God that is greater than all our sins. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we come to this idol of sex and sexuality today, and we understand that our hearing of these things is going to be colored by our experiences, our past, and even our present. And we ask you to cut through all that stuff, Lord. We sexuality. That is a focus of our culture. Consider how many times we hear about sexual identity and sexual preference and sexual expression, the way that sex is used in advertising and entertainment. It's everywhere. And people define themselves based on who they are sexually, or who they like sexually, or how they identify. We're living in a world that is saturated with it. Did you know the largest porn site in the world has 64 million visitors every day? That's more than Netflix, Twitter, or Amazon all put together. Look at the Institute for Family Studies. More than 60% of Americans have cohabited with a romantic partner outside of the marriage relationship. Look at what the CDC says. The combined number of STDs reached an all-time high in 2019 of 2.5 million. And in the years since 2019, that number has only gone up in the preliminary studies. Our culture is obsessed with worshiping sex and sexuality. And we should not be surprised by that. Lost people act like they're lost. And the problem is that this obsession with sex and sexuality is running into the church at breakneck speed. Consider these statistics based on research conducted among people claiming to be Christians. 47% of families in the U.S. report pornography as a problem in their home. Pornography use increases the marital infidelity rate by more than 300%. 11 is the average age that a child is first exposed to pornography. 11 years old. 94% of children will see porn by the age of 14. I wonder if we asked our kids to just be honest with us and raise their hand. I wonder how many of our little ones would say, yes, I've seen it. 56% of American divorces involve one party having an obsessive interest in pornography. 70% of Christian youth ministers said that they have had at least one teen come to them for help on this issue. 68% of church-going men view porn on a regular basis. Of young Christian adults 18 to 24 years old, 76% actively search for porn. 59% of ministers said married men seek their help for porn use. 33% of women aged 25 and under search for porn at least once a month. A generation ago, that would have been an astounding number. And quite honestly, I'm surprised it's that low in the church today. 87% of Christian women have watched porn at some point. 55% of married men, 25% of married women say they watched at least once a month. 57% of preachers say that porn is an addiction that is the most damaging issue in their congregation. We brought the idol of sex and sexuality into the church. And it's past time for us to face it head on and hear what God has to say about it and submit ourselves to what He has to say. Our sermon text this morning, if you want to turn there, is 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. And Paul is writing to the church in Thessalonica, which is a large city in Greece. It's a hub of trade in the first century, and the folks in that city, the Greeks in large, were known to be very open sexually and adventurous, and so that was all over their culture. And that way it was a lot like us today. Look at 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, starting in verse 1. Paul says, "Finally then, brethren, we request and exhort you in the Lord Jesus, that as you receive from us instruction as to how you ought to walk and please God, just as you actually do walk, that you excel still more. For you know what commandments we gave you by the authority of the Lord Jesus. For this is the will of God, your sanctification." Whatever God's will is for you, your sanctification. That is, that you abstain from sexual immorality, that each of you know how to possess his own vessel in sanctification and honor, not in lustful passion like the Gentiles who don't know God, and that no man transgress or defraud his brother in the matter, because the Lord is the avenger in all these things, just as we told you before, and Solomon warned you. For God has not called us for the purpose of impurity, but in sanctification. So he who rejects this is not rejecting man, but the God who gives his Holy Spirit to you. God calls us to stop worshiping sexuality and to be set free to worship him. This is what God wants from you. This is his will for you. That you would not do what our culture does that worships sex. You're to be different. Set apart. Sanctified. Set apart. Holy. And he says the first thing you got to do, you got to start with this. Abstain from sexual immorality. That's God's will for you. To abstain. When you were baptized into Christ, you were justified. You went into that water of your grave. Your sins are washed away, and it's just as if you'd never sinned. You're raised as a new creation, justified. But then the process of sanctification begins. That process whereby God has set you aside, and he's working on you to make you what you ought to be. You're becoming more and more like Christ, ideally, as you're following the lead of the Holy Spirit in your life and putting to death the desires of the flesh. Doing what God says. That's what Paul's talking about. And the first thing you do, he says, hey, you've got to abstain from sexual immorality. Now, what is sexual immorality? Any takers on that? No. Okay. It is any form of sex, sexual expression, or activity that takes place outside the covenant relationship of marriage between one man and one woman. Amen. I was very specific for a reason. Okay? Because who tells us what marriage is?
God.
God, not a court. Not a politician. Not me. Not the elders here. Not a denomination somewhere. God tells us that marriage is between one man and one woman, and his design for marriage is that it would be for life. A lifelong commitment where you selflessly love that other person. And that is what he has designed sex to be a part of. That covenant relationship. So any type of sexual activity outside of that relationship between one man and one woman is sexual immorality. That would include pornography. Even if me and my wife are going to look at some porn to get some out. No, that's sin because you're bringing someone else into that covenant relationship. Something else sexual into that covenant relationship. That would include going on a date and doing some really intense touching through the clothes on your date. But we're not going all the way. We're just doing this. That is sexual activity outside of the covenant marriage relationship. That's sexual immorality that Paul said, hey, this is God's will for you. Abstain from sexual immorality. We're called to be different. And if you're not looking at this stuff, if you're not going to certain bases on your day, you're different. You're different. And that's a good thing. So that's the negative. He says, abstain from sexual immorality. The next thing he talks about is the positive. Honor God in your sexuality. In verse 4, he says, let each of you know how to possess his own vessel in sanctification and honor, not in lustful passion like the Gentiles who don't know God. Possessing your own vessel. Now, is that talking about your boat in the yard? No. Your own vessel. It's a fancy way. Some of you guys got that, y'all. There you go. Okay. It's a fancy way of saying, hey, let each one of you control your own body. Control your body, the vessel that God has given you. Control your body. Look at the way people who don't believe in Jesus use sex. It's a game. It's a fun activity. It's a competition to see if you can get there. And you get tired of one partner and you move on to another one. It's hot heavy for a while, but then it kind of gets a little boring and you want something different. We're to be different because we know God. The people in the world don't know God. That's why they're running after those things. We're to be different. Each one of us possess our own bodies. Each one of us control our own body. God knows that each of us has a different struggle there. Whatever your temptation is, you're to control your body. Your sexuality should be used to honor and worship God. If you're single, then choose to sacrifice by remaining chaste. By saying, no, I'm not going to give in to those desires. If I have those desires, I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to look at that. I'm not going to go there with that person. I'm going to commit myself to Jesus. Honor God by controlling your body. If you're struggling with same-sex attraction, deny yourself. Deny yourself. Say, you know what? I know that I want the intimate and anything outside of the covenant relationship between one man and one woman is sin. So I have to say to myself, no. And guess what? When you tell yourself no, just like the single person who wants it, but they say no. When you say no, even if it's same-sex attraction, you are honoring God by controlling your body. You're worshiping God. And you're choosing to submit to His will for you. And that's the call. And people in our culture say, well, that's not fair. That if I'm attracted to someone of the same gender, God wants me to be happy and God wants me to love and be loved. He does want you to be loved and He does want you to love, but it has to be within the parameters that He sets for His universe. Yeah. It is for your good and His glory. And I'd be lying to you if I said He wants you to be happy. He doesn't want you to be happy. He wants you to be holy. Yes, happy is temporary. Holy is eternal. Saying yes to yourself now, whether it's same-sex attraction or opposite-sex attraction, hetero or homosexual, either one. Saying yes to yourself now and know that Jesus could mean eternity apart from Him. And so the call is to deny ourselves and say yes to Him. If you're married, man, celebrate God. Celebrate what He has done. Because sex is a wonderful thing that He has given for a husband and his wife to enjoy one another. And every time you come together, that is a recognition and a celebration of Him making the two one. And enjoying what He has given us to enjoy. So it's worship. And if you're in a place in your life where you don't have any desire for sexual activity, you're not tempted by it, listen, praise God for that. Praise God for that. Be thankful. And focus all of your energy on Him and praise Him. Be careful. We're going to talk about that in a minute. Be careful. Nobody's too high fall. But celebrate. And give all of your energy to Him. Now, parents, we've got to do a better job. We must do a better job explaining a biblical perspective on sex and sexuality to our kids. And we in the church, we need to do a better job. We do a great job saying, no, no, abstain, don't. That's hot, don't touch it, right? We do that. But we fail to give the positive of the joy and the wonder of honoring God with your sexuality. How awesome that is. And our kids are going to build a view of sex. Where do you want them to find their understanding? At the gym with their buddies? Playing some game called Fortnite with their friends? Having conversations that way? We want them to learn what sex is all about while they're on a date at homecoming? John Comer said this. He said, love and marriage, sex, this is the thing that most young people are thinking about 24/7. It's all-consuming for a lot of singles. The scriptures have so much to say about all of the above, but sadly, the church has said so little. The church has done a great job saying, don't have sex before you get married, don't have an affair, don't download porn, and all that's true. But we haven't done a great job at giving young people a theology of love and marriage and sex and the rest, a way to think about this from God's vantage point. Hollywood does the exact opposite. Its propaganda is loud and ubiquitous. It screams at us everywhere we go. So the church has got to step up, tackle the hard questions, help people think about marriage and sex with the scriptures, and in line with what Jesus' vision is. He's right, isn't he? He's right. Sex is just one of those topics we don't like to talk about in church. We want our kids to be scared to death to think about it. But we need to help them understand God's kingdom, because it's a beautiful thing. And it's crucial, because this world has turned sex into an idol, and folks in the church are worshiping that idol. We chase it and worship it and get enslaved by it and eventually destroyed by it. But sex is a blessing from God. And when you express those things within the boundaries of marriage, it's a wonderful thing. It is worship, and it is so much better than the trash this world's throwing at you. So much better. God's promise is sure. Looking back at 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 6, he says, "No man transgress or defraud his brother in the matter, because the Lord is the avenger in all these things, just as we told you before, and Solomon warned you. For God has not called us for the purpose of impurity, but in sanctification. So he who rejects this is not rejecting man, but the God who gives his Holy Spirit to him." I want to point out two promises in these verses. First of all, God is going to judge sin, including sexual sin. Paul here has a view toward infidelity in the church family, the husband who cheats on his wife, or the wife who has an affair with one of the deacons in the church, the preacher who takes advantage of his position to have intimate moments with a lady in the church who trusts him when she shouldn't, that kind of thing. God is going to judge all sin. And Paul wants us to remember this promise of God as we consider whether we're going to worship sex or not. Remember that no sin is going to go unpunished. And if you hold a biblical perspective of sex, you're going to be laughed at and dismissed by this world. When we say that sex outside of marriage is sin, what does the world say? You're crazy. Two consenting adults, that's all that matters. And now they're not even saying adults necessarily. Two consenting people, or three, or four, however many. As long as everybody's okay with it, go for it. And when we say, no, this is what God says, they laugh at us, they call us backward pigs. That we're unenlightened. That we don't love people or care. We don't know what we're talking about. When a young man refuses to look at those pictures with his buddy, hovering over the screen, they're going to get picked on. Just remember, they're not rejecting you. Who are they rejecting? God. They're rejecting him and what he says. And he's the judge. Okay, the second promise that I take great comfort in is that we are not alone in this battle against sexual sin. Paul reminds us that we have the promise of the Holy Spirit. Paul reminds us that Holy Spirit is with us. You're fighting against temptation. The Holy Spirit calls you to obey God. The Holy Spirit enables you and empowers you to be able to abstain from sexual immorality and worship God, honoring his view of sex. So he calls us, again, to stop worshiping sexuality, be set free to worship him. And we know people, many of us here today even, know what it's like to be chained to sex and sexuality, to be enslaved by it. How do we break those chains? How do we protect ourselves from worshiping that idol of sex? If we want to be set free from the idol of sexuality, we must raise our standard. We can't hold ourselves to the same standard as the world around us because we've been set apart. We've been sanctified. And with the time that we have left remaining, I want to turn over to the book of 2 Samuel. And we're going to look at the story of King David. We're going to see if we can learn a couple of lessons from a situation in David's life. And the first thing I want to point out to you is this. Everybody is susceptible to worshiping the idol of sex. You may think that you are too strong for that. You may think that you're too old for that. You may think you're too married for that. Or you're too young for that. But everybody's susceptible. You know why I know that? What did the Bible say about David's heart? He was a man after God's own heart. David was a guy that loved God, and he followed God, and there were some things about David that God says, that's a guy after my own heart. That's the wonderful thing to say about somebody. Can you imagine the God of the universe saying, you know Luette? Luette is a woman after my own heart. How about that? Would you like to have that said about you? Woo. If the God of the universe said, you know what, that might pass. I'll tell you, he's a man after my own heart. That'd be great, wouldn't it? But guess who's susceptible to sexual sin? Miss Duet, why? Key, Jessica, all of us. If David was, we are. Look at what happens with David. 2 Samuel chapter 11, we're going to start reading in verse 1. Then it happened in the spring, at the time when the kings go out to battle, that David sent Joab and his servants with him and all Israel, and they destroyed the sons of Ammon and besieged Rabbah. But David stayed at Jerusalem. Now when evening came, David rose from his bed and walked around on the roof of the king's house. And from the roof he saw a woman bathing. I'm careful not to point in any direction here. A woman bathing, and the woman was very beautiful in appearance, right? She said, stop, okay. So David sent and inquired about the woman, and one said, is this not Bathsheba, the daughter of Eliam, the wife of Uriah the Hittite? David sent messengers and took her. When she came to him, he lay with her. And when she had purified herself from her uncleanness, she returned to her house. The woman conceived, and she sent and told David, said, I'm pregnant. Lessons to learn. Don't be in the wrong place. Don't put yourself in the wrong place. David, it was springtime, and where were the kings? Gone off to war, to fight wars. Where was King David? Hanging out in the house. Where should he have been? Out there. Is he in the right place? No. And also, when evening had come, he got up out of his bed. He'd been laying around eating Cheetos and playing Fortnite all day long. Then he gets up in the evening. I guess, let me tell you something. When you are out in bed most of the day and then you stay up late at night, only bad things happen late at night, right? That's what my parents told me, only bad things happen. So again, he's in the wrong place. And he wasn't where he was supposed to be. And if he had been where he was supposed to be, he wouldn't have seen Bathsheba and we wouldn't have had his story. You got to guard your heart. Don't go where you have no business being. Be in the right place. 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 14. Paul says there in 2 Corinthians 6:14, don't be bound together with unbelievers. What partnership have righteousness and lawlessness? What fellowship has life with darkness? If Jesus has your heart, hear me, especially you young people, hear me. If Jesus has your heart, you're in the wrong place if you're dating somebody who doesn't love Jesus. If there's that little girl or that little boy that is just the moon, you know, the sun, they're everything to you and you just love them, they're so wonderful. If they don't love Jesus, you better not be there. Don't put yourself in that situation. Because it's hard enough. If you got a young man and a young woman, or older, it doesn't matter, okay, but if you got two people who love Jesus, and yet they're not married, but they're physically attracted to each other, it's kind of hard to say, no, we're going to wait, we're not going to dishonor God, we're going to control our body. It's kind of hard. Now, you take one of those people out of the equation and substitute it with somebody who doesn't love Jesus and they just want to get it on. Isn't it kind of hard to be the one that says, no, I'm going to honor God? So don't put yourself in that situation. If you love Jesus, don't put yourself in an entangling relationship with somebody who doesn't love Jesus. Don't go there. Guard your heart. We've got this responsibility to raise our standard. Billy Graham never rode in an elevator with a woman alone. He never went to a hotel room first. He always had somebody else go into his hotel room and check it out, make sure there wasn't any ladies hiding in the closet. That's the kind of thing. He never rode anywhere in a car with just him and a woman. Why did he do that? He was obsessive over that thing. We just had a vice president who had that same kind of standard where he wouldn't put himself alone with a woman. Why? He did it because he raised a standard. He protected himself, he protected his marriage, he protected his family, he protected his ministry and his legacy. He wasn't willing to go to the wrong place or be in that situation. Don't allow yourself to be in a situation where you can be tempted easily. Be where you're supposed to be. And don't be afraid to look crazy to this world. It's too much at stake. The second lesson we'll learn is to count the cost. How might this story have ended up differently? If David, when he saw Bathsheba, he stopped looking long enough to think of the consequences of his actions. What if he thought ahead and he said, okay, now if I go through and I see this attractive lady and I'm going to pursue that relationship, oh, she's married, well, we're going to pursue the next step. What if he stopped and thought about it? You know what? This one might have sinned is going to get her pregnant. What if he had realized, if he counted the cost, that actually, in partial in judgment for his sin, guess what's going to happen to that baby? It's going to die. It's going to die. David will feel forced because of this infidelity where he's slept with this woman. He's going to get into a position where he will murder her husband by giving the command that when they go to attack, the other soldiers are to withdraw from this man so that he gets killed. So David murdered. Okay? What if David, standing on that rooftop, looked down and he said, hold on a second, I may end up killing a man over this. His relationship with Bathsheba would help fan the flames of war and death within his own family and children for a generation. What if he had just stopped and counted the cost? Is it worth it? Had he known what the outcome would have been, guess what he would have done? He'd have turned around and he'd have left and he'd have done anything to stop thinking about anger. Just a couple of chapters later, in 2 Samuel, chapter 13, there's a sad, sad situation of sexual sin involving David's children. His son, Amnon, is driven by desire for his half-sister, Tamar. He pretends to be sick so that she will get sent to help him, help feed him and nurse him back to health. And when he gets her alone in the room, he grabs her and she begs him, don't do this. You know, if you desire me like this, go talk to our dad and he will marry us. Just don't do what you're trying to do. You know what he does? He rapes his sister, his half-sister. Rapes her. He's consumed by lust. And so he does this deed. And in 2 Samuel 13, 15, it says, then Amnon hated her with a very great hatred. For the hatred with which he hated her was greater than the love with which he had loved her. And Amnon said, get her away from me. Get out. Go away. Amnon had a good time for a little while, didn't he? He should have counted the cost. Lust would quickly turn to hate and shame. Tamar's older brother, Absalom, would eventually murder Amnon, his half-brother. So Amnon's sin cost him everything. Should have counted the cost. Sexual sin promises pleasure, and it delivers pleasure for a brief time. But eventually, it replaces that pleasure with the chains of shame and regret, the hunger for the next hit. This is one of the main dangers of pornography, which you may not realize it is. And as you look at pornography and all those, what they call novel images or videos, new people, new things that you haven't seen before, it gives a dopamine hit to your brain. It's drugs. And your brain gets to where it just hungers and desires for that stuff. And you always want to go to the next click, the next click, the next thing, the next thing. Sexual sin, that's the way it is. You go from person to person. And this one fulfills you for a little while. But then this one's going to do it. And then this one's going to do it. And you're never going to be satisfied. Count the cost. Is what that sin is offering you worth what it could cost you? And the answer is always going to be, so run away. Run away. When David sees Bathsheba bathing, he has no control over what goes on in his brain right there in the moment, does he? If you think he does, you're fooling yourself. All right? There's this beautiful woman. When you see that, things happen in your brain right there. You can't control it. But what happens next, you can control. See, the problem isn't the first sight. The problem is that he leaned into it. He watched. He thought. He obsessed. He pursued. And he ran after it. If he had just run away, it would have ended differently. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 18. Paul says, flee immorality. Every other sin a man commits is outside the body, but the immoral man sins against his own body. Do you not know your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have from God, and that you're not your own? You've been bought with a price. Therefore, glorify God with your body. And the main way you need to glorify God with your body in this issue is run away. Run away. Look at the world around us. There's bare skin everywhere. And there's tight clothing everywhere. There's temptation everywhere. We can't escape that. But what we can do is run away. Not take the second look. Not pursue those thoughts and fantasies in our head. And this world will tell you, you can look as long as you don't touch. Listen, when I was a younger man, I heard men in the church say that very thing. It's okay to look. I'm married. That's okay as long as I don't touch. I can look. There's no damage in that. Lies from Satan. Where your brain goes, guess what? The rest of it's going to follow. It's where your heart's going. That's the problem. I've heard women say basically the same thing. Well, I don't care if he looks. We're married. He ain't like he's going to buy. He's got me. It's okay if he looks. Or she'll look. And it's okay to look. Because I'm doing anything. The war is being fought in the battlefield of your mind. You have to know that. Flee immorality. When you indulge those thoughts and fantasies, you sin against your own body. You weaken your own spiritual strength and resolve. So flee. Run away. Pray, read Scripture, meditate on God's Word. That's how you're going to keep your way pure. Talk to Jesus about it. Occupy your mind with Scripture and prayer. Practice accountability. Allow someone to have access to your phone and your computer and your search history and your apps and your social media, all that stuff. And if you're married, let your spouse do that. Guys, don't hide stuff from your wife. Let her look at your social media and your search history and all those things. Ladies, let your husband do that. Have that accountability in your marriage. In Great Britain, there were studies done. The same thing in the U.S. suggests half of all affairs start where? Social media. Social media. Or texts. Maybe you're catching up with that old friend from high school on Facebook. And one thing leads to another, and you start sharing how you're going through a tough time in your marriage, and they're going through a tough time in their marriage, or they're single now, and one thing leads to another. It's a horrible thing. Parents, you should have access to your kids' phones and their tablets or computers or whatever they're using. You should know what they're looking at. Hold them accountable for it. And if you don't have that kind of access, you need to take away that cell phone. Amen. Or that tablet or whatever it is. You need to take that responsibility very seriously because eternity is right now. Don't make excuses. There is no denying that we live in a world that worships the idol of sex and sexuality. And chasing that idol has led to so much chaos in the lives of countless numbers of people. Careers, marriages, families, and churches are destroyed by sexual sin. We got to watch out. careful little eyes what you see. It's the second glance that ties your hands as darkness pulls the strings. Be careful little feet where you go. It's the little feet behind you that are sure to follow. It's a slow fade when you give yourself away. It's a slow fade when black and white are turned to gray and thoughts in vain. Choices are made, a price will be paid when you give yourself away. People never crumble. Sex and sexuality to worshiping Jesus. For some of you, the decision to make is to receive prayer from people who love you, people who care. Maybe you need to make a decision to receive counsel, that people would help you, your brothers and sisters would help you along the way as you're dealing with these sin issues that are weighing you down, or in dealing with wrongs from the past and those wounds that you're dealing with. Maybe that's what you need to receive today, help as you're dealing with this stuff and process. You have to make a decision today. Sex and sexuality are a blessing with which we can worship and honor God. But too often we've allowed it to become an idol that destroys us. So be honest with yourself. Be honest with Jesus and your experience of the idol of sex and sexuality. And count the cost of sexual sin. Be honest with yourself there. What are you risking? What needs to change? We thank you for your mercy, your grace. Because there are people here today who have been hurt in the past because of sexual sin. And there have been people here who have given themselves away, a piece of themselves away, and then have been broken because of it. There are people here who have been abused. And something that is so intimate and beautiful that you have given them, someone else has come along and warped that and twisted it. And we're thankful, Lord, that you can provide healing, you can provide restoration in those things. We're thankful, Lord, for those who struggle with sexual sin. We're thankful that not only we have your promise of judgment, but we have the promise of the Holy Spirit to help us in those battles. We have a family of believers who can help us along the way and encourage us as well. Lord, thank you for not throwing us away. Thank you for loving us. Lord, we pray that you would help us to make the decision that we need to make, that you're calling us to make today. We pray in Jesus' name. We're going to stand and sing a decision right now. What do you need to do? How is God calling you to respond to his message today?
See on the portals, he's waiting. killing yourself at a young age. And there are so many people here that would sit down and talk to you. He left a mother that I couldn't hardly say anything. Because she was so struck with pain. Don't do that to your parents, and don't do it to yourself. If you need anything from me, there's a whole lot more people here. But I've got a tender heart. I can see somebody hurt, and I start crying. Please, don't do anything like that. And they do the older people. There's no need of it.
Good word, brother. If you need help, talk to somebody. God gives a church family for a reason. Amen?
Amen.
We're here to be here for each other. If you are dealing with some issues, especially the things that we talked about this morning, you need some counsel, you need some help, talk to me, talk to one of our elders. These guys love you, and they want to be there for you. You're not in this battle alone, okay? I'm going to remind you, whatever the Holy Spirit has put on you today, things that need to change in your life, don't make excuses and don't put off changes.